Hello and welcome to our webcast. I am Ann Newman and I will be your host today for our talk on rapid evolution of enzymes for pharmaceutical applications, hosted by 7th Street Development Group and sponsored by Codexis. Codexis is a leading developer of biocatalysts. Their technologies bring improved manufacturing approaches to sectors ranging from the pharmaceutical industry, fine chemicals, flavors and fragrances, to animal health, food and agrochemicals. Today, Codexis bio-based products are used at more than 50 drug companies around the world, including Merck. We have Jim Lalonde from Codexis presenting today. He will be talking for about 45 minutes, and that will leave us time for a couple of questions. If you have a question, please type it into the question section to submit it. I will be compiling questions throughout the talk, and at the end, Jim will answer as many questions as time allows. If we do not get to your question, but you would like a response, you can email me or Jim the question, and we will get back to you with an answer. So let me introduce our speaker. Jim has served as Senior Vice President of Research and Development of Codexis since February of 2014. He served as Codexis' Vice President of Research and Development from December 2005 to February 2014. Jim joined Codexis in July 2004 as Director, Biocatalysis and Chemical Development. Prior to joining Codexis, he worked at Altus Biologics Incorporated and Vista Chemical Company. He is also co-author on a variety of research publications and a co-inventor on numerous patents. Jim holds an Honors Bachelor of Science from Lakehead University and a PhD in Organic Chemistry from Texas A&M University. So with that, Jim, I'll let you take the floor.
All right, great. Well, thank you, Ann. And thanks for everybody for dialing into this webinar. What I want to do over the next 45 minutes is walk you through introduction to our technology, and tell you how we're developing methods to rapidly evolve custom enzymes for pharmaceutical manufacture. And then I'll go through some case studies that illustrate how this technology works, and then once I'm done, I'd be happy to answer some questions. So first of all, Codexis, by way of introduction, what we have is a technology we term CodeEvolver, and that allows us to rapidly evolve enzymes for chemical manufacturing. So typically what we do is we take an enzyme either from our internal libraries or from databases or simply from nature. We'll take a gene that codes for an enzyme, and we'll use our technology to create genetic libraries of variants, or we make mutations, so we'll make thousands of variants, and we'll screen those enzymes in high throughput for our application of interest, find the best of these, and recombine what we're learning from our screening experiments into making subsequent rounds of libraries and then continually improving the enzyme until it fits our targets. So these enzymes are highly evolved and they're designed to work under process conditions. We can eliminate multi-step synthesis with efficient enzyme processes. They're inherently green, low waste generating, and I'll go through some examples that illustrate that. So we work very closely with our customers. We kind of have the unique degree of freedom where we can customize an enzyme to fit a process. So unlike traditional chemical development where you're perhaps accommodating the sensitivities of a catalyst by a process, in this case we're turning that on its head. We're envisioning the ideal process and then evolving the enzyme to enable that process. So that requires a tight interaction with our customers. We once we're successful in evolving the enzyme, we'll supply that on large scales, and we've delivered many metric tons of enzyme over the years for literally hundreds of applications. So typically the way we work is we'll look at an existing chemical process or an early synthetic route to a chemical product for the pharmaceutical industry, and we'll look for opportunities to eliminate steps to come up with a much more streamlined process, to eliminate wasteful steps like protection or deprotection chemistries, and come up with an enzyme that enables that much more efficient synthesis. So if we look at the overall CodeEvolver technology platform, it's modular. So again, what we're doing is we're starting with an enzyme from nature, from our libraries. We're taking the gene that codes for that enzyme. We're making libraries of mutations. We're expressing those enzymes in high throughput and testing them in our chemical application, finding the best of these and learning from our experiments, taking what we learned, making new libraries, and continually improving the enzymes until we have one that meets our process demands. So it's a modular approach. We typically start out with in silico modeling. So we have computer modeling for many of our enzyme catalysts. And so we can take those models, we can dock a substrate of interest. And we can't yet use a computer to design the perfect enzyme without doing any experimentation. But what we can do is use molecular modeling to dramatically decrease the search space. So that's really important and allows us to rapidly develop these enzymes. When I started in this field 25 years ago or more, biocatalysis tended to be the last resort of process chemists. But just in the last few years, we've crossed a tipping point where all this technology has come together, and it's many pharmaceutical companies are using it as the first line of defense in creating efficient processes because of these tools that I'm going to describe today. So we have these in silico models that help us first screen in silico or in a computer our enzyme libraries, and also help us design the library. So if we don't have one that accommodates a substrate of interest or doesn't do the chemistry we want, we can first create in silico models that help us design our genetic libraries. We'll then take that information and we'll design our libraries, and there's been a dramatic decrease in the cost to synthesize genes, and so we can very rapidly create libraries of thousands of variants using our proprietary tools. Take those genes, express them in an expression system, take the enzyme product, and then screen those thousands of enzymes in high throughput. So we've invested a lot in robotics and process-relevant screening technology so that in a microtiter plate, we can look at our reaction of interest. We'll take the information, and I'll talk to you about how we do that, and we'll use that to design subsequent libraries. So that is allowing us to create an increasing palette of chemistries. We are continually developing new enzyme technologies that we can use for to bring to bear against reaction of interest. Now, we've invested a lot in software analytics. There's been a dramatic decrease in not only the cost to synthesize genes, but also the cost to sequence. So when we make a library of thousands of variants, it's cheap and fast to just simply sequence all of them, but even before we test them. So we have a lot of genetic information. Once we do test those enzymes, we know not only what worked well, but more often than not, most of the mutations we make are not beneficial, and we can learn from that as well. But to sift through that large amount of data, we need efficient algorithms to help us do so. And lastly, when we have that enzyme of interest that meets our process specifications, then we can rapidly scale it up and supply ton quantities to our customers. Another way of looking at this is shown on this slide at CodeEvolver Directed Evolution Technologies, where the first component is the diversity generation. So we're looking at a family of genes here, and you can see there's several mutations shown here in black, because we don't at this point know if they're good or bad. We screen those enzymes in high throughput and use our software systems to assign a coefficient to how good or how bad those individual mutations are. Take the best of the mutations, recombine them, and test them in high throughput, and go through this in an iterative cycle, basically continually improving the enzyme products until we have the one that meets our specifications. So this is based on 13 years as Codexis, and even more prior to that as Maxygen, in development of these technologies, and based on hundreds of millions of dollars in investment, and it's protected by hundreds of patents and patent applications. And so we can really benefit from all this technology development. As I said, we're at a tipping point where in the last few years it's just become very rapid for us to develop a customized enzyme. Now, what can we develop these enzymes to do? Of course, we want enzymes to work under chemical processing conditions or in the application of interest. So in the early days, we worked on things like detergent proteases and shift the pH optimum of those catalysts. I'll talk about sitagliptin, where we create a new enzyme activity on a substrate that didn't exist in nature prior to it, and there was no natural enzyme that would work on that. We are continually optimizing for pH, temperature, and removing inhibition of these enzymes. And we're working on stability more often than not, and we can really push the environment that an enzyme can work in. It's remarkable that, for instance, in a carbonic anhydrase program that I'll touch on in a bit, where we can have enzymes that work above the boiling point of water and in highly alkaline media. In the case of sitagliptin, we have enzymes that are working in 50% dimethyl sulfoxide. So most enzymes from nature would be rapidly denatured under those conditions, but these enzymes are evolved and so are quite active and stable under those conditions. So we've been, over the last 13 years, overhauling drug manufacturing. I'm touching on three examples here where we won the EPA U.S. Green Chemistry Challenge Award for these blockbuster drugs. In the case of Lipitor, we developed an enzyme that actually adds cyanide to an epoxide, so very strange and unnatural activity, but this enzyme being evolved to do so is quite stable and active for that reaction, and that's how this key intermediate for atorvastatin, the active ingredient in Lipitor, is made. In the case of Januvia, the active is sitagliptin. This enzyme works in dimethyl sulfoxide. It works on a substrate that never existed in nature, and I'll touch on that later on the talk. And the third blockbuster drug that we can talk about is simvastatin, and this cholesterol-lowering drug was enabled to be manufactured by a very efficient enzyme process by the evolution of, an enzyme that actually adds a dimethyl butyrate ester to monoclonal J to give us simvastatin. So in each of these cases, we're making very large changes to the protein. So it requires a combination of tools. It requires very high levels of mutations, which of course can't be done randomly because statistics is working against you. So you need to have tools that allow you to accumulate positive mutations and remove deleterious ones. And so the tools that we've developed allow us to do so with increasing speed. So we start with the end in mind. As I said, we have the luxury of evolving the enzyme to fit the process. So we can design the process basically before we start and saying what solvents we want to use and temperatures and throughput, and then evolve the enzyme by taking a gene that codes for the starting enzyme, creating libraries, screening them in high throughput, testing, and going through that iterative process until we have the enzyme that enables that process. So the first chemical example I want to touch on is atorvastatin, and this was done finished in 2005, and in 2006 we won the U.S. EPA Green Chemistry Challenge Award. In this case, it's a very unusual reaction. Halohydrin dehalogenase normally catalyzes the interconversion of an epoxide with the halohydrin by addition of chloride, but we evolved the enzyme to take cyanide so that it forms a carbon-carbon bond, and this is then irreversible cyanation. And it gives a very clean hydroxynitrile intermediate. So hundreds of metric tons of this product have been manufactured using this enzymatic process. The process that it replaced involved cyanide under alkaline conditions in high pH, high temperature, in forming hydroxynitrile intermediate that gave not only the desired product, but a wide range of byproducts that had to be separated by distillation. So this enzymatic cyanation addressed a problem. It was one of just simple chemoselectivity, doing this cyanation under very mild conditions, and this has been a very successful process. I want to touch on carbonic anhydrase, not as an interesting chemical reaction, but as a very nice way of illustrating the technology. This catalyzes a relatively trivial reaction of CO2 plus water, which gives bicarbonate and a proton. And so this enzyme can be used for carbon capture, because it accelerates the capture of CO2 into water, and if that water has a lot of amine in it, then that capture is irreversible until it goes to desorption, where it can be heated, and you have a pure CO2 stream coming off. So the enzyme carbonic anhydrase catalyzes the hydration of CO2 to give bicarbonate and a proton, which is then captured by the amine. So we need an enzyme that tolerates very high pH, 11.5-12, in 50 weight percent diethanolamine or ammonia, so very high alkaline pH, and very high temperatures, because the enzyme needs to tolerate that desorption of above the boiling point of water. So we started with an enzyme, a mesophile, that had good activity for hydration of CO2 that somewhat tolerated low concentrations of the methyl diethanolamine, and evolved over 10 cycles to give 4 million-fold improvement with a high-degree mutation. So this illustrates our approach and some of the technologies, and I refer you to this reference if you want to dig into some more details. We recently published in Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. But basically what we did was we took that mesophile enzyme and we started with a library generation tool we call SnowCaps. And what that allows us to do is to make every possible single amino acid change along that chain. So for a 300 amino acid protein, you have 20 amino acids. So that gives you a library size of about 6,000 if you want to make every possible one amino acid change. And what that allows us to do is to scan the protein and find mutations that are beneficial potentially for our process of interest. In this case, we found more than 80 mutations that were beneficial. One of them actually gave a two orders of magnitude increase in stability. And you can see this is a logarithmic scale. We're looking at stability increase over evolution variant. And we had, over the course of evolution, a 4 million-fold increase in stability of that enzyme. So really remarkable that by the end of the program, we were screening these enzymes in autoclave because it was above the boiling point of water in very highly alkaline medium. So what we learned from this, of course, is that nature has this method, this algorithm for creating new enzymes that has a wide degree of versatility, and we can make enzymes work in environments that were never anticipated. So if we look in the case of what happened over the course of evolution, you can see 10 rounds of evolution. In red, I'm showing the sites of mutations. So this protein, the monomer, forms a tetramer, which is the active catalyst. And as you might expect, most mutations were accumulated around that tetramer interface to hold the tetramer together so that it wouldn't come apart under the boiling above the boiling point of water. But there were other mutations throughout the protein. So it's a really powerful tool that allows us to rapidly increase the, for instance, in this case, stability of proteins. Over the course of these projects, we've developed algorithms that help us sift through this large amount of data. As I said earlier, the cost to sequence is coming way down, so we sequence practically everything in our libraries in parallel with screening. So we have a lot of data to sift through, so we create algorithms that help us navigate the very wide sequence space. And that helps these programs go very fast. Here's two of those algorithms here. One we call ProSAR, which is developed around the time with the Lipitor program. So what ProSAR allows us to do, and what people had done in the past, was if you made a family of mutational variants, you'd screen and you'd find which genes overall were good and which overall were not good. But you couldn't get individual mutational information. So you would basically find genes that were good, but you might not know which mutations were beneficial and which ones were deleterious. But what ProSAR allows us to do, since we're looking at high levels of mutations, we're seeing the same mutation in different contexts, we can do a linear least square analysis, assume that the contributions of each mutation act independently, and then provide a coefficient to how good or how bad in a model the individual mutation was. And take the predictions from the model, recombine what are predicted to be beneficial mutations, and test them and test that algorithm. Since then, more recently, we have Mosaic, where we've pushed it further. We have a lot more data to handle. Luckily, computational power is going way up. Sequencing costs are going way down. And so we can get a lot of sequence information and sift through that and go through these programs that much faster. Not only that, the Mosaic algorithm is a higher order computational model, so it allows for interactive effects. So in some cases, two beneficial mutations might have a clash if they're close to each other in the protein, for instance. And so this allows not only the coefficients for individual mutations, but coefficients predicted for interactive effects. So that's just been another step change in terms of how fast we can sift through data, make more robust models, and test those. And so we continually decrease the amount of work it takes. So for instance, the Lipitor program was huge. It took probably around 20 people, a couple of years. Now a typical program takes five or less people a few months to do the same thing. So it's been a real step change in what we can do, and that allows us to look at a lot more chemistry with fewer people a lot faster and access new areas. Of course, automation continues to move forward, and we've invested a lot in that. So we have our assays are miniatured and miniaturized and run in microtiter plates. So we can very quickly screen in our labs in Redwood City on the order of 10,000 different enzymes per week on many different programs. So so it's a great capability that we have to develop programs. I want to touch on another chemical example, and this one's going to illustrate how we continue to develop the technology. This is simvastatin. Here's the two chemical routes that have been used prior to the development of the enzyme process. So starting from lovastatin that you get from fermentation, you can either deprotonate this alpha butyrate ester with a very strong base, as you might imagine, and methylate to give this alpha methyl dibutyrate, which is what's found in simvastatin, and then cleave off your protecting groups to get simvastatin. Another route hydrolyzes to give monocholine J, and this is a very easy hydrolysis. You need to then protect these groups selectively and not be the reactive one, and acylate to give you the alpha methyl butyrate ester, and then deprotect to give you simvastatin. So wasteful protection, deprotection, acylation steps, ones that generate side products that need to be removed. So what we really would like would be a direct route going from, say, monocholine J to give simvastatin. And since there's an enzyme in the organism that makes lovastatin, you might expect that that same enzyme could possibly use to put on the alpha-dimethylbutyrate ester. And in fact, that's the case. So Yi Tang at UCLA demonstrated that you can not only take that same enzyme and evolve it to take the alpha-dimethylbutyrate, but you could take away its requirement for a very large molecular weight acyl donor, which required a very large protein to deliver that thioester, and to replace it with this very small group. And so it was very promising results, very dilute, you know, 1 millimolar substrate, a lot of enzyme, but very promising. So we collaborated with Professor Tang's group at UCLA, and we're able to improve that enzyme 1,000-fold to come up with a direct route to simvastatin, eliminating the need for the protection, deprotection step, and having a direct monocholine J to simvastatin process. So that enzyme's efficiency was improved 1,000-fold, mostly by catalytic efficiency, but also by solvent tolerance. So the processes that was developed won the Green Chemistry Award in 2012. It was a 25-fold reduction in waste, 4-fold reduction in the requirement for the acyl donor, and eliminated the need for the protection, deprotection steps. But this program was done basically blindly, as most evolution programs are done. We use our algorithms to help us design our libraries, but it's interesting when we can to go back and see what changed over the course of enzyme evolution. And in this case, we learned something that we helped us refine our tools that I'll touch on when I'm done this segment. So this was a very profitable collaboration with folks at UCLA, Professor Tang, who I already mentioned, but also Todd Yates for crystallography and Ken Houck for molecular dynamics. And if you look at the process, we're taking that enzyme, LOVE-D, and we're evolving it to take a much smaller acyl donor. As I said, the natural pathway uses this acyl ACP thioester with this protein to deliver the thioester, and Professor Tang was able to evolve it to take this very small, much more usable acyl donor for the alpha dimethyl thioester. So over the course of 9 rounds of evolution, in terms of the catalytic efficiency of kcat over km, you see that there's more than a 400-fold increase in the catalytic efficiency. So that combined with the process stability gave the enzyme that's used for that commercial manufacture. So if you look at the crystal structure, it's done by Professor Yates' group, you can see that there is a narrowing of the active site, but it's really not clear, as shown on this slide, what happened over the course of evolution that gave us this really dramatic increase, this more than two orders of magnitude increase in catalytic efficiency. Because if you overlay crystal structures, and this is one of the wild type overlaid with a sixth round variant, even though this sixth round variant was 250 times more efficient at doing the chemistry, they basically overlay completely. So it's not apparent from the crystal structure what's going on here. And so the enzyme employs an active site serine that's activated by a tyrosine. And in both the wild type crystal structure and the wild and the evolvent round six, you have basically a complete overlay of that active site. So the X-ray structure didn't reveal anything that we could learn on the enhancement of catalysis. So Ken Houck's group decided to take a molecular dynamics approach. So of course, a crystal structure is just a snapshot, a static view of the enzyme, but enzymes are fluxional in character in their catalysis. And so molecular dynamics has become an increasingly powerful tool in delineating what's going on in terms of catalysis when we develop these enzymes. And we're able to now incorporate these molecular dynamic tools in our in silico screening. At the start of this presentation, I touched on our modular approach, the first modular approach being in silico modeling. And up until very recently, we were also using static crystal structures for looking at these interactions. But now we're able to incorporate molecular dynamics and get a much more informational rich, and once we're successful, much more predictive model for what's going on. So if you look at the results in the molecular dynamics simulation, looking at the wild-type enzyme, you can see, and this is showing multiple snapshots over the course of the dynamic measurement, that most of the time that active site tyrosine is not in the active conformation. So rarely is it in the right position for catalysis. And over the course of evolution, progressively more and more, you have pre-organization of the active site. And in this ninth round evolvent shown here, you can see that for most of the time over that simulation, the model predicts that the tyrosine is in the right conformation. So that jives well with what we're seeing in terms of our experimental results and testing of activity. And so it seems that that molecular dynamics was the right model. And what's shown here is a very nice correlation between KCAT and the percent time that that tyrosine is in the right conformation. So that seems to be a very nice explanation of what's going on. But why did the crystal structure not explain that? Well, recall that the acyl thioester is delivered not as a small molecule, but as a protein complex. And so Professor Houck's group reasoned that perhaps there was some protein-protein interaction that was also at play with the LOVE-D wild-type enzyme that that was lost in the small molecule. And if you look at the crystal structure, of course, proteins crystallize with interactions, and the LOVE-D wild-type enzyme crystallizes as a dimer. So there's a protein-protein interaction. As it turns out, pre-organizes the active site and makes it look like it's in the right conformation. But in the in solution, apparently, it's not. And so their group embarked on molecular dynamic simulation of the protein in the packing structure. And their model predicts that it's flexible. But with that protein-protein interaction in the dimer, it's in the right conformation, whereas in the wild-type monomer, recall that it's not. It's rarely in the right position for catalysis. So that the protein-protein interaction somehow stabilize the catalytic triad and give you the right orientation for catalysis that mimics what's going on with the acyl ACP. So they also embarked on a molecular dynamic simulation for that LOVE-D acyl protein complex, and the molecular dynamic calculation, or simulation rather, predicts that that interaction, that protein-protein interaction, also gives the tyrosine in the right orientation. So if you look at the results from the molecular dynamic simulation and looking at that tyrosine-lysine interaction, recall that it should be short for catalysis to occur, and in the LOVE-D dimer and also in the natural LOVE-D acyl-ACP complex, the model predicts that it is in the right position for catalysis, whereas in the LOVE-D wild-type monomer, it's not. Most of the time, that tyrosine isn't in the right position, and so we don't get good catalysis. But over the course of evolution, you know, without knowing it, we were creating variants that progressively had that tyrosine back in the right orientation until we got to the ninth round of evolution, where you can see that tyrosine-lysine distance is optimal most of the time. And so we restored the catalytic function and eliminated the need for that protein-protein interaction. So over the course of evolution, basically we restored catalytic function by eliminating the need for the protein interaction to orient the active site. And so without knowing it, we basically restored catalysis. So we are now incorporating molecular dynamics and hopefully learning from what nature has taught us here, and making progressively smarter models and getting faster in our programs. So the last example I want to touch on is sitagliptin, and this is a program that we won the Green Chemistry Award in 2010 with Merck. And in this case, we're making chiralamine. Of course, chiralamines occur in many different drug molecules, and so it's a valuable type of enzyme catalysis. Now, the sitagliptin is the active component of the drug Januvia for diabetes treatment, and the manufacturing process prior to development of the enzyme process involved a multi-step asymmetric hydrogenation. The first step is formation of this enamine, and then that enamine is hydrogenated efficiently by a ruthenium catalyst using a Josephos as a ligand. A couple drawbacks here. First, the hydrogenation has to be done at very high pressure, and of course you're using a rhodium catalyst at high temperature, and the selectivity is good but not great. So you need special reactors to run these hydrogenations. You can't run it in standard pharmaceutical reacting kit because of the very high pressures of hydrogen. And so as this drug became more and more in demand, you would need to build more and more of these expensive manufacturing kit to accommodate that. So the ruthenium hydrogenation with Josephos ligand, after that hydrogenation, you need to treat with an adsorbent to remove any residual rhodium from the drug substance. And then, as I said, you've got good but not great optical purity, so that needs to be upgraded by crystallization. So you've got 1, 2, 3, 4 steps to give you the chiralamine. What you'd really like to do is go directly from the ketone to the amine in high purity by a simple reaction that's enabled by a transaminase. And it's been known for quite some time that these enzymes, these transaminases, catalyze the transfer of ammonia from a donor like isopropylamine, for instance, to a wide range of ketones to give you a chiralamine. So it's a very nice process. Unfortunately, this molecule falls outside of the scope of natural transaminases. There was no known natural transaminase that had the desired activity. Most natural transaminases have very little ability to accommodate bulk on both sides. You can accommodate an aromatic group or bulk on one side, but on the other side, anything larger than methyl really slows it down, and basically there was zero activity on this ketone. So the approach that we took with our collaborators at Merck was to first start with a truncated substrate where there's trifluorobenzyl group is replaced by a methyl group. We tested a range of transaminases and found one that had good activity on the truncated analog. We then evolved that, improved the activity on the truncated analog to establish activity, and then looked at, in our homology models, our computer models based on related enzymes at the active site. And we predicted that there was a clash occurring that, in these enzymes. So what we're looking at here is down the carbon-nitrogen axis of the chiral amine. And so you can see this trifluorobenzyl group basically clashes with one pocket in the enzyme. So we designed libraries that allowed for opening up of that pocket. And it wasn't, you know, one or two enzymes, but it wasn't millions. It was more like 1,000 or so enzymes that were based on this rational approach. So a computer model can't tell us exactly what enzyme to make, but it can help us dramatically decrease the search. And so we were able to come up with a, using this model, a variant that had activity that was measurable, extremely low, but measurable, so that with low concentrations of the ketone, high concentrations of the enzyme, long time, 24 hours, we got half a percent conversion. So it's only a few turnovers in 24 hours, a very slow enzyme, but albeit one that gave us enough of a toehold that we could start climbing that that sequence activity space and find improved enzymes. And so over the course of evolution, we opened up that active site, and this is a model of our final variant. You can see now in the active site, the computer model predicts that there's a good accommodation of the trifluorobenzyl group that explains improved activity. So over the course of evolution, what happened to that enzyme? First, we were able to design in silico a starting point and then apply our combination of mutation library design and high throughput screening to increasingly improve the enzyme. The final catalyst had 27 mutations, and as you might expect, a lot of those were around the active site. In fact, of the sphere of amino acids that are predicted to interact with the substrate, amongst the ones that we changed, two of them were catalytically essential residues, and seven were changed. So if you look at the final catalyst, you have a lot of change in the active site. You also have changes on the surface of the protein because we needed to accommodate the solvent that would dissolve that substrate and product, and that was 50% dimethyl sulfoxide. So the enzyme, as evolved, is quite stable and active. Active on this unusual transformation and stable in the unusual environment of 50% dimethyl sulfoxide. So over 11 rounds of evolution, we made more than 35,000 variants that we tested in high throughput. The final process, almost 38% ketone in the reactor, and in 12 hours and 50% dimethyl sulfoxide, you get virtually full conversion and virtually selectivity for the enantiomer of interest. We have trouble detecting the off enantiomer. So it was a very dramatic improvement in the process, and probably the most significant thing, it eliminated the need for very specialized high-pressure hydrogenation equipment, eliminated the need for the expensive rhodium Joseph-Foss catalyst, and replaced it with a very simple process to run where we're using an enzyme that could be used in standard reaction kit. So the CodeEvolver technology, as I described it for pharmaceutical applications, as you can see, it's very broad. It's allowing us to create new enzyme activities that we continually to develop, enzymes that are fit for purpose for chemical manufacturing. As we improve the technology, I told you in the case of Lipitor, it took in the order of 20 people, now on the order of 5 people. Instead of years, it's months. So it's a very rapid, very high increase in the rate at which we can develop these improved enzymes. So we can access a lot more markets, and so we're working with folks in other industries now, in bulk chemical and in food applications, where the cost drivers are tighter. And we're also getting involved in earlier stage drug molecules so that we can, because we can very rapidly get enzymes to enable synthesis, we can come up with these enzymes very quickly. We're applying it in other areas as well. It's an agnostic technology in that we can improve enzymes for many different applications. So using it to develop enzyme replacement therapy drug candidates, enzymes that can survive the in patients, for instance, oral delivery, so it can survive the low pH and proteases that are involved in the digestive tract. And we're also working with partners that have exclusively licensed or non-exclusively licensed it for their use in-house. We're continually building the platforms. I touched on a few of them. I touched on the transaminases, which is a great way to make chiral amines. In subsequent webinars, we could talk about amine reductases, but rather than taking or making primary amines, we can make secondary and tertiary amines directly, coupling large pieces in efficient syntheses. Ketone reductases, now this is probably the best way to make a chiral alcohol, is these enzymes have very broad capabilities to work on a wide range of chemical space. Large or small molecules, hydrophobic, hydrophilic, very easily synthesized using this asymmetric ketone reduction to alcohol. Monooxygenases, esomeprazole, for instance, can be manufactured using our sulfoxidation reaction that uses air as the oxidant to asymmetrically form this chiral sulfoxide. I touched on a specific single example of an acyl transferase, and many of our projects we do are of that sort, where it's a specific enzyme doing a specific chemistry for one product, and the technology lends itself to doing that very well. Amine oxidases are very efficient catalysts for the manufacture of, for instance, these chiral proline derivatives. So we continually increase the palette of enzymes, the range of chemistries that we can use and access a wider range of molecules, to the point now where, as I said, many large pharma companies are using biocatalysis as the first choice rather than the last choice. So the technology, we continue to improve it. It's modular. Up front, in the in silico modeling, we're using static models from X-ray crystal structures, but also molecular modeling tools to predict first structure where a protein crystal structure doesn't exist, and also molecular dynamics to bring in the functionality of the catalysis. We have dramatically improved our library synthesis, so our ability to make genetic libraries very quickly and very cheaply. And we're benefiting from the low cost now of sequencing and getting a lot more information per experiment. We have high throughput robotics, which allow us to look at tens of thousands of variants per week. We're increasingly developing new chemistries. And we're investing in software algorithms that help us sift through the large amounts of data that we're getting so that once we're successful, we can rapidly scale up and deliver metric ton quantities of our enzyme. So it just remains for me to thank a very highly talented team at Codexis, not only present but many past members. Also, we've had very fruitful collaborations with pharma companies like Merck, Pfizer, GSK, Novartis, and AstraZeneca. We appreciate those interactions. Specifically, in the case of Merck, collaborated with Jeff Moore, Matt Truppel, Greg Hughes, Jake Janey, and others at Merck in the sitagliptin development. So at this point, I'd like to thank you for dialing into the webinar, and I'd be more than happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thanks for a great talk, Jim. I always learn a lot whenever I listen to these talks. For all the people listening in, I'd like to launch a poll just to find out how many people are watching this. Sometimes we have one person at a computer. Sometimes we have more than that. We just like to get an idea of how many people are watching. So if you could fill in that poll, I'm going to continue to collate the questions. So if you have a question, please feel free to type it in, and we will hopefully be able to get to all of the questions that we have so far. So while they are filling in the poll, I will start with some questions, Jim. First one, in addition to amino acid substitutions, do you also explore additions and deletions?
Yeah, we do. In some cases, if we look at a structure, we can see how we can manipulate. So, by far, we're looking at amino acid changes. But in some cases, for instance, we've taken proteins that were multimeric and linked together chains to make them monomeric to improve the stability, for instance, in some cases of those proteins. So that would be an example of an addition. Sometimes deletions occur in some programs, basically fortuitously, or when something doesn't go right, and if the enzyme happens to turn out to be better, then we go forward with that. But those are two examples of additions and deletions that we've done.
Okay. How do you select the protein scaffold for engineering when a novel activity is aimed? Do you have software to predict the evolvability of the scaffold?
Yeah, so if we want to look at a new type of chemistry, oftentimes we're looking at an analogous reaction. So we, as chemists, can, for instance, in the case of the halohydrin dehalogenase, predict that you could use different nucleophiles other than chloride to do that chemistry. And in that case, that was known from the literature that trace amount of activity existed for that reaction. So we're often looking at analogous chemistry. In the case of amine reductase that I mentioned, we're using what we know about related enzymes and then looking at the active site of the enzyme and designing away or adding components that we need for the new reaction. In terms of evolvability, oftentimes that's hit or miss. So whether or not an enzyme responds well to evolution, it's more difficult to predict. But for instance, in the ketone reductases, I showed you a lot of different molecules that those enzymes work on. Many of those are coming from the same backbone, so one starting point gives many different opportunities. In the case of carbonic anhydrase, we started out with actually a thermophilic enzyme, as many people might reason, that had lower activity but was somewhat more thermally stable. That enzyme was not at all evolvable, but when we switched to the mesophile, we were off to the races very quickly, found it malleable towards evolution. So in terms of evolvability, just by virtue of our more than 12 years in the business, we have backbones for many of these that we know to be quite malleable, and that gives us a leg up on doing these evolution programs.
Okay. What is the average length of one round of evolution?
It ranges in terms of how difficult the assay is. Typically, generating the library is days, and generating and growing it is very quick. It's the testing. So if we have to use an HPLC test, we'll work very hard to make the method very short, but it still tends to be the bottleneck. So those can take on the order of 6 weeks. If it's complicated, 3 weeks or less if it's something simple. And that's something that evolution cycle is something we're continually working on reducing by our testing methods and by the way we generate our libraries.
Okay. All right, here's another one. Can you comment on how you produce these enzymes, expression system, E. coli, other, and form of enzyme, whole souls, crude lysate, semi-purified extract, or purified enzyme, or immobilized?
Yeah, so there's a lot there.
The answer is
yes to all of those, but basically we have a range of platforms. E. coli tends to be simple, so that's our go-to for simple process. But if the enzyme requires, for instance, needs to be secreted or it's got glycosylation, then we would use either yeast or bacillus platforms. We've worked with fungal platforms in the past. So whatever the process dictates. over the course of evolution, we're not only identifying activity hits, but by the way we screen, we're identifying expression hits. So that over the course of evolution, we often have an increase in expression of the enzyme. And so by the end of the evolution program, we have an enzyme that expresses very well. It's by far the major protein that's produced by the production system. And so we then have high throughput ways that we can lyse, remove cell debris, and if needed, purify the enzyme for testing. Typically, we want to go as fast as possible, and so we'll use simple methods to process the enzyme. Once we're done, typically applications where the protein, say for instance, is 50% of a powder that we or a liquid formulation that we can supply, that's sufficient for most everyone's needs, as long as we can demonstrate that nothing is carried through in subsequent steps, and that's easy for us to do. In some other processes, I mentioned food, for instance, those processes typically use immobilized enzymes. So in those cases, we'll immobilize an enzyme on a resin and then have a flow-through system where we have the substrate flowing through a column and our product coming out the other end. So basically, it's whatever the process dictates. We want to be as cheap as possible, simple as possible, and so over the years, we've developed methods that fit all those opportunities.
Okay. You touched on the fact that pharma companies are now using Codexis biocatalyst as a first resort. Are these companies licensing large quantities of enzyme directly to use in their preliminary in-house chemistry?
Yeah, no, the way we're set up is we can do very quick screens, and so we supply to our customers kits or panels where they can very rapidly test. For instance, a K-Red, if you want to look at a range of enzymes, we can supply a kit containing multiple enzymes, sometimes 24 or more enzymes, where a chemist can screen and test to see if they have starting activity. If they report back the results to us, we can help them since we know what sequences exist in each of those wells, we can predict how to improve the enzyme and then supply it. So if we start with somebody who's in phase one, for instance, and you need kilogram quantities of a molecule less, typically you wouldn't want to do an evolution program, so you'd have a good enough enzyme that you, say, would use a small amount of that enzyme to make that small amount of product. As it goes through the clinic, we can improve the enzyme if need be. And if it gets approved, then we can develop a manufacturing form of that enzyme together with the customer.
Great. Sounds very easy, the way you explain it. There's another one. Are you trying to develop new assays to increase the throughput of the assays, maybe ultra-high throughput assays, for example, flow cytometry?
We're always looking at improving assays, but our philosophically our approach has been to improve libraries. So we're unusual in that because our predictive models are very good, our starting points are often very good, our libraries tend to be relatively high in terms of the percent active. So in other words, what I mean is in the case of, if you look at the carbonic anhydrase paper, you can see that many of those libraries were 25 or 50% active or the reaction that we're interested in. So we can get a lot of beneficial diversity without ultra-high throughput screening. In the case of sitagliptin, where we had very low activity, or almost no activity, we used a mass spec to detect very low concentrations of the desired product. And so that can be very high throughput. We steer clear of anything that's not process relevant, so anything where you're going to put a fluorescent tag, for instance, on it, you'll end up with an enzyme that's good for molecules with a fluorescent tag on it, but it won't work in the natural or the desired reaction. So our approach has been high-quality libraries, moderate throughput screening for the most part, and that's done quite well for us.
All right, can you express other types of modified biologics besides enzymes, such as antibodies or peptides?
Yeah, we can. We can express a wide range of biologics, and there's nothing special about enzymes. For the purposes of this talk, I focused on pharmaceutical catalyst applications, but in other cases where we're producing, we can produce proteins that aren't catalytic.
Okay. What steps, if any, are being used to bring this type of technology into drug discovery, namely combinatorial chemistry?
Yeah. So Robert Osborne's talk, he touched on P450 enzymes, for instance. And those enzymes are interesting because they can hydroxylate relatively complex molecules directly. So they do hydroxylation of unactivated carbon-hydrogen bonds. So people are using those types of enzymes to take a scaffold, a molecular scaffold, and elaborate it to put functionality in positions that would be difficult to do any other way. So that's been an approach. And of course, any of the other enzymes that I described, transaminases, ketone reductases, can be used to make unique molecules that can be screened in high throughput for drug discovery applications.
Great. Have you worked on enzymes that catalyze multiple reactions, for example, polyketide synthesizes?
Yeah, we have. We've put together pathways, for instance, that can take, in one case we have cellulosic sugar, we put in a pathway, in this case it was a whole cell transformation, that would take cellulosic sugar and access to fatty acid biosynthesis pathway, take those enzymes, and then have an enzyme, a fatty acid reductase, a FAR enzyme, that would reduce, once we hit a targeted chain length, to give a fatty alcohol. So what we were trying to do was come up with a pathway that made C12-14 fatty alcohols, and we were able to do that and actually make the right proportion of the mixture to give surfactant range fatty alcohols that could be used for the manufacture of surfactants. So that's one example. But yeah, we've worked in the past with multi-enzyme pathways to make interesting molecules.
Next question. Is there any interest in incorporating non-natural amino acids in the enzyme scaffolds? Would that be beneficial?
For the most part, it's not. It's not required. You know, the nature has given us just this tremendous diversity that we can barely handle, right? If you want to take it, for instance, a 300 amino acid protein, the number of, if you varied every position and made every possible variant, is something like 20 to the 300th power. So it's a tremendous amount of diversity, and that gives us a, you know, we continue to be amazed at the malleability and the different chemistries we can do in different environments. So we haven't had to resort to using unnatural amino acids. The one case where that might be interesting is where you want to put a specific tag. For instance, you want to have a different chemical reactivity in a protein at a specific group. But other than that, we really haven't had a need for using unnatural amino acids.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Maybe we have time for one more. Could you elaborate on your work with Lipitor and if there is any sort of positive future with that drug in Codexis?
Yeah, our Lipitor work, as I said, that was done in 2005, and we built the ProSAR technology that we use today on the backs of that program. That chemistry is still being used. Lipitor, of course, is now a generic drug. But it's still very widely prescribed around the world. And it's my understanding that most of the world's Lipitor is still made using the Codexis developed process. So, yeah.
Very interesting. Okay, and with that, I think we're about out of time. So if we did not get to your question, you would like a response, please email me or Jim the question. His email is on this slide, and he will get back to you. Also, I would love to thank Jim for a great presentation. Thank you so much for doing this today. Also, an email will be sent with a link to a recording of the webcast, so you will be getting that probably tomorrow or Friday. And lastly, I would like to thank our sponsor, Codexis, for their support of our free webcast. I'd like to thank you for attending our webcast today, and we hope to see you at future webcasts by 7th Street Development Group. Have a great day, everyone. Thanks again, Jim.
Thank you.